welcome back to NAF Forum. We're here today to talk about the COVID-19 pandemic. We're looking at it retrospectively, as I said before, from our own personal points of view and also the points of view as nurses, as I said before, that we're all nurses in different capacities. So at the moment, part of the panel, we've got Veronica, Nordia and Natasha, as I said, she would be joining us. So I'm going to ask them questions about their experience in COVID, how they dealt with it. So I will start with Natasha, just because she's our guest for today.
Thank you.
How are you today?
Yeah, I'm feeling good, thank you. I've just listened to a church service, so I'm feeling very revived. Good.
Good. And I can see you're enjoying your garden.
I am fanning the flies. So if you see me doing that, it's just the flies, everybody.
Okay, don't worry, they're not going to harm you. So, just wondering, so during the lockdown period, and as I said, we're all nurses, did it affect your job? Because you're a school nurse, is that correct?
Yes, so I'm a school nurse. I mean, I've got to admit, I wasn't taking this corona very seriously. When I first heard about it, I thought, oh, do you know what? Just get over it. It's only a bit of flu. But then when things started to really kick off at work and it started to get serious and we were getting protocols in, getting PPE in, having to sort of come up with policies for managing the children, that's when I realised, along with watching the news and see what's happening, that it is something really serious. So schools, I got sent home because I came under the 12-week vulnerable scheme. So I got sent home, I think it was around about the 16th of March, and then schools sort of shut down. Our school made the decision actually to shut down the week before the government did, to send all the children home just to keep everybody safe, really.
Okay, and I'll just ask Nordia the same question in terms of the, you know, as I said, the COVID pandemic, hearing about it and the lockdown, how being a nurse, how did it impact you?
I mean, it did impact quite intensely because my background is basically an intensive care nurse and I do training. So it just meant that we had to come up with the same things in terms of looking at the different levels of nurses, whether or not we can actually get more numbers working in critical care because of the surge that we were anticipating, writing scopes of practices, looking training. So in total, we've trained quite a large number of nurses so that they can actually work safely, looking after critically ill patients. And this actually became really serious from the fact that when we started having our units being, because I work for a large hospital with quite a number of beds, and when we were actually needing to double up patients in bed spaces, then you look and you're thinking, oh my days, this is really bad. So, and then all the talks with PPEs, etc. So I'm quite grateful that we were okay with ensuring that we all had the necessary PPEs to work in. So that was a great thing for us. But it has been mentally, physically exhausting.
Yeah, and I'll come back to that because I think mentally it's affected a lot of people. But Veronica, you cope, because you work in the community, don't you?
The impact was very significant because we needed more in the community to try and prevent them from coming to hospital. So our workload actually increased a lot. And doing that, we're saving a lot of lives by not getting the vulnerable adults into hospital where they can get the disease. So it was a huge risk as well. At the same time, the workload increased. So, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, from my point of view, I locked myself the question. So I work as a pain specialist nurse, but my background is cardiothoracic high dependency nursing, and I hadn't done that for about 10 years. So when we heard about redeployment happening and nurses that have got critical care backgrounds will be redeployed into these areas, so I was quite nervous. However, it was also thinking that we, as a pain service, we will still need to manage patients that are in pain. And if there are any traumas or some surgery that will go on, and unfortunately some surgery did happen, what will happen then? Because all the junior anaesthetists, the trainee anaesthetists apart from the consultants, some of the consultants also actually, sorry, had been redeployed to ITU. And we work jointly with the anaesthetic team. So when we're not at work, they cover us. And during the day, we work together in terms of managing patients' pain. So at that point, they were like saying, all nurses are going to be redeployed, but what will happen to our service? I know in some trusts, the pain services did stop. But with us, the senior staff actually remained on in their roles, and then the junior staff were redeployed. So I actually wasn't redeployed. But again, as Nadia had mentioned previously, it was about dealing with the stress and mental exhaustion of our staff and dealing with this. Because at that point, at the initial stages, like you say, Natasha, when it first came out, it was like, yeah, whatever, this isn't going to come to London or the UK, sorry. But before you know it, after the February half term, bang, you know, you look at Italy, you look at Spain, France, oh my gosh, it's getting closer. And then the hype then in the media, it was like, actually, people are dying of COVID-19 and it's at our doorsteps and our trusts are changing their practice.
Yeah.
So mentally, how did you, were you able to cope with that, Natasha? I know you work in the school.
Yes.
You were, you had to shield. So,
yeah.
How did you cope with that?
Initially, like I said, you know, I wasn't sort of taking it seriously. And then we had to sort of come up with all these policies. We have a small medical room. So it's thinking about, right, if children present with signs and symptoms, how do we manage that? I must admit, the pressure for me is I've shed tears for people like yourself, my colleagues. I've also had an element of guilt as well, because you think, okay, as nurses, I'm a nurse, I should be out there helping.
Yeah.
But then obviously I'm in a position that I can't. So the emotional and psychological aspect of it for me at work wasn't as bad. To be honest, I don't think it's on the level of what you guys have experienced, because I haven't experienced that at all. Like I say, the school shut down. The emotional and psychological for me was a personal thing, having caught the virus, my family having caught the virus, my sister initially testing positive. So that's where the emotion and the psychological, rather than a professional. But you know, I've spoken to Veronica, I've spoken to other members of staff, I've seen, heard friends, nurses, doctors in tears on the phone to me, and it breaks my heart. Absolutely. Yeah. And it just frustrates me, because I think, you know, you go into the army, you go into the police force, there's an element of risk, your life can be taken. But as a medic, we shouldn't really have that. The most we should have is a bit of back pain. Do you know what I mean? And that should be sending us off. People shouldn't be dying. And as much as the public thank you guys with the clapping, I think the government really need to step up now and have a look and stop saying NHS heroes, because you guys have been working like this for time. You know, it's not just now. But yeah, so for me, the psychological was a personal thing rather than professional, definitely.
And Nadia, your mic is on mute at the moment. Us off now.
Sorry. No, yeah. I was just trying to be quiet during everyone's talking. But
okay.
I mean, it's like what you've just said, Natasha. The thing for me is that working in, because I've always done intensive care nursing, you know, looking after the sickest of the sick from qualifying, and that's like over 16 years now. But when it's like with a pandemic, no one actually, what we have never been given is the recognition for the actual job that we do. And it's like, it's not all of a sudden we've become heroes. We've been heroes with our, you know, unrecognized heroes, because we have always been working like this. It hasn't changed our practice at all. You know, saving lives, that's why we all became a nurse, to try and, you know, help humanity in some way. But it's like, and I was talking to some of my colleagues when the SARS, because I've worked through the SARS and all those other outbreaks, you know, of my time. But working through a pandemic, which is worldwide, and having to, you know, and literally seeing colleagues, you might not know them, but your fellow healthcare professions who is actually in that bed in an intensive care unit and literally battling for their lives. It's not something that you can actually walk away and just think that, you know, like, yes, this is just another day at the work, at the office. It is more than that, because when you look, you can say that could actually be me. That could actually be somebody that I actually care about or that I've actually worked with, you know, over the years. And it's been tough, not just on myself, but I'm quite privileged that I haven't been exposed daily with that frontline work. But when I do, and when you see colleagues who've actually working in these, you know, and working in PPE is not easy. Because, you know, after an hour, you just want to come out of that space and take off the mask and everything else, because it's very restrictive. And having, you know, because we've been doing data in terms of what roles people have been doing, just to know, you know, if they're a fellow healthcare. And one of the hardest ones so far was when you've actually seen like 6 nurses and healthcare worker battling for their lives. You know, and that is really hard. And it was one shift. And people will say, you know, working in ICU, you'll see death and come across death all the time. I can tell you that's not true. Because I you know, if I've seen a death or experienced someone dying, it's like 1 in every 6 months or something like that. And even if not, you know, quite more longer than that. And when you have the COVID and you have like more than 1 people dying on your shift, that is hard. Yeah. You know, that is hard. So yeah. So I'm just saying is that when I said to you guys that it's been both mentally and physically exhausting, you know, we've even extended. I've had to change my working schedule during the COVID, because I normally work Monday to Friday. And when you see we're doing, you know, 7-day-a-week cover, just to cover, you know, training and support for staff that are actually directly involved in care, frontline care. It's been tough. You know, I've had tears, I've had people crying, even, you know, when you look, people have actually been broken.
Mm. I mean, I see where you're coming from, because I when I speak to the junior staff that were redeployed, they also spoke about their experiences in ICU. Veronica, have you, in terms of mental health, how you felt, how you dealt with things emotionally?
Well, in my case, as a rapid response nurse, it's very scary because you're going into a place where you don't know what you're going to encounter. But some of the presentation are totally different when they're referring these patients to you. So it was very frightening personally as well, because thinking about 2 little kids that I have, I didn't want to go and get something and bring it to them. At the same time, I have duty of care to these patients, so I have to do it. So I just have to put on a front and do what I'm supposed to be doing, because at the end of the day, this is what I have been signed off to do. So again, protect myself as much as possible. As Natasha mentioned clearly before, Nadia that mentioned it, that you can only wear the PPEs for certain hours, and then obviously, but I still have to do it. So it's very, very, not tiring, but emotionally wise, it's I see it as, it's very draining, if you can think about it like that. But apart from that, I just have to do what I have to do and just pray to God that I don't catch anything. However, that did not stop me from getting some symptoms of COVID, even though the test that I did previously showed negative. I actually had to get tested twice because I was still having the symptoms, although they said it was still negative. But again, with 2 little kids, as I mentioned before, I have to self-isolate for a while. And this was very, very sad moment for me, because I'm not able to see my children. I wasn't able to touch them, to speak to them. And as a single mother, if I did not have the support of like a partner, what would I have done? So again, you're thinking about yourself, you're thinking about your children, but the job has to be done. So we're heroes in our own right, but we're heroes all the time, as Natasha mentioned. We're not heroes. We've been doing this for a long time. And some of us have to do it because this is what we're passionate about, putting other people as well first as our own family. But yeah, it's very emotional. As I cried a few times, not because I wasn't able to do the job that I'm supposed to be doing, because I'm thinking about this little kids as well. So at the same time, it's personally, as Natasha mentioned before. So yeah.
Yeah. It's been fun. Yeah. No.